I'm Gwen Ifill, and welcome to a special expanded edition of the Washington Week Webcast Extra. Our topic this week, healthcare reform. Your questions, our answers. Covering the story this week, Ceci Connolly of the Washington Post, Peter Baker of the New York Times, Naftali Bendavid of the Wall Street Journal, and Jeanne Cummings of POLITICO. We'll start with a kind of a nuts and bolts question from one of our viewers in Oregon. Jeanne in Oregon and actually Mark in Texas had the same question. If the government offered a competing health care plan, what would prevent companies and corporations from dropping health care coverage to employees?
Ceci? It's an excellent question. It's a concern that's been raised by a number of people. And so far, most of the proposals being considered on Capitol Hill, and we know that this is still very much in flux, a number of different bills being worked on. But right now, the idea is that if you would have that option, at least for a period of several years, there would be a prohibition saying to employers, if you presently offer your workers health insurance through the private market, you cannot drop that and, in essence, enable or force workers to move into the government alternative because they're very concerned about that sort of shift. Most of them think that after maybe 7 years, if this thing were to be up and running and see how it's going, then you might allow that kind of movement.
I have another question from Joanne in Texas, Naftali, who wants to know, will people who do not want or need health insurance be forced to buy it?
Probably so. I guess you could take issue with whether anyone doesn't need health insurance.
Yeah.
That's, I guess, a matter for debate. But all the plans that are being seriously discussed right now have what's called an individual mandate, which means that an individual would have to buy health insurance. And the reason for that is that part of the calculation here is that you need to have some young, healthy people as part of the system in order to spread the risk. It's something that we've talked about earlier. But that for this whole thing to kind of hang together, the idea is that everyone is covered, everyone takes part, and everyone, if they can afford it, pays into the system.
Jeanne, let's see, this is from Jeff in Indiana, who wants to know, is there a provision in any of the proposed bills allowing labor unions to take over or administer health insurance plans?
No, there's nothing like that. It's the plans that would be in the exchanges that they would create would be private plans. They'd be all the private insurance companies that we're all used to, and a new alternative. That would either be the government-sponsored plan, which would be run as a nonprofit, but under the style of a private insurance company. It's not supposed to be subsidized by the taxpayers. It's supposed to exist based on its own premiums, or a co-op system, where the co-ops would be coming in and buying from there and offering services. And so There's nothing in the bill that would allow labor unions to suddenly take over the system.
Although, as I think about this, and I've not heard anybody discuss it, but I suppose in theory a labor union could decide to try to form a cooperative. I think it would be incredibly difficult because you need large numbers of people to participate, and then you need to hire doctors and get them on contract, et cetera,
et cetera. Rosalie from Ohio wants you to talk a little bit more about co-ops. what does it mean? She's not certain what they are.
Well, that's because there are very few in this country today, really only two, one in Minneapolis and one out in Puget Sound. It is, I suppose, think about a condo co-op, or Senator Conrad likes to point to Lando Lakes. The idea is that these are nonprofit entities. And they gather together for a certain purpose. You see them for telephone service, utility service, especially in the Midwestern part of our country. They're run by the members. So they have volunteers that get elected to a governing board, et cetera. That's the basic concept. The tricky thing is that healthcare is a little more complicated than phone service. And that's where some of the experts are saying, we're not certain how easy it would be to get these things up and running.
I have a political question for you, Peter, from Mark in California. Are there safeguards in keeping politics out of health care decisions if a different party controls Washington in the future?
That's a very good question. I mean,
yeah.
You know, and that's where we're at right now with this whole idea of whether you go with the Democrats-only bill or not. Historically, the big entitlement programs that have been created in this country have been the product of bipartisan support. It may have been initiated by Democrats in the case of Social Security and Medicare, but Republicans more or less bought in, at least enough of them to give it a broader imprimatur. If we end up with a plan here that is Democrats only, and particularly if 2010 turns out to be a, you know, pivotal midterm election year, you could see a lot of retrenchment and revisiting a lot of decisions again and again and again until you get a broader societal buy-in to something that everybody can more or less live with.
So where does that stand right now, this great bipartisan solution we've been talking about, Naftali?
I think it's pretty remote. Everybody's very quick to say we still are hoping for it, we're still holding out for it. The Gang of Six and the Finance Committee did meet last night, and they're meeting again before the end of the recess. But I think most people are coming to feel that the political ground has shifted enough, particularly in August, that the likelihood of the two parties coming together and producing something with significant support on both sides, that just seems increasingly far-fetched. Mm.
I have a question from Gloria and Stan in New York. Will important surgical procedures be denied to people once they've reached the age of 70 or 75? This is part of the question people have had about not death panels so much, but about end-of-life care. Yeah.
And rationing, absolutely. The short answer is no. The legislation, the people driving this whole effort don't envision anything like that occurring. But in fairness, let's just sort of point out two other realities. One is we have rationing in our system every day right now. It's just not rational rationing. Hmm. And it's done largely by insurance companies. And for most of us, that means it's done by our employers, because we get our health coverage through our workplace, and it's the workplace that decides how much money they want to spend. So that gives you an idea of sort of who to be frustrated with. Also, the goal of this health reform is to get at more science-based care, so that, and sometimes you hear the term comparative effectiveness research. So it might be looking at different drugs, different surgeries that are out there, something called watchful waiting, and to look at a condition and really figure out what does the data tell us is the best move. And in some of those instances, it might not be the operation that somebody really thinks they want and need.
But if I could add, the legislation specifically says that comparative effectiveness research cannot be used to deny service or to ration in any way. It has a very specific ban of that sort of behavior. In addition, the Democrats constantly harp that they're not going to be the party that supports anything that includes age discrimination. And so the idea being that someone ultimately may not get that surgery, but it would be, in an ideal world, based upon the decision of their doctor about whether this is really the best route for that patient to go.
Peter, Mary Sue from Indiana asks a question that the president refers to a lot. She says, if the president wants to remove us, provide us health care, shouldn't we all have the same health care that Congress enjoys?
It's a good question. It's certainly an easy line that politicians use now for a number of years. You see the television ads on with the congressman with his feet up saying, you know, he's got his health care, why doesn't he provide it?
Well, I've heard the president say it too.
And the president said it. Teddy Kennedy has said it, obviously, as he has fought this brain cancer over these last number of months. That gets at this question of, a single-payer kind of program, a nationalized program, and, something that Barack Obama, as a state senator, had in fact supported, but today has said that the current system would be too disruptive to too many Americans to put in that kind of single approach. So too many Americans are wedded to their own doctors, their own plans, their own current health care, and he wants everybody to know that you don't have to lose anything you have now if he puts through the plan that he would like to put through.
But these exchanges actually are getting us, would get the public closer to what members of Congress have. Single payer isn't what members of Congress have.
That's true.
What they have is a broad buffet of choices. And if you are a individual who you're self-employed, you don't have any choices. Right. If you're a small businessman, you don't have any choices. But if you have this exchange system, you would have a similar buffet. And so it actually moves us closer to what members of Congress get.
I have a Medicare question for you, Ceci, from Barbara in New York. Does the president plan to dismantle Medicare Advantage? I'm a happy subscriber, she says.
And there are a lot of those happy subscribers. Medicare Advantage, of course, is the managed care option for Medicare recipients. I believe about 14 million people now have chosen those plans. And they're very popular because often they provide a few extra benefits, maybe eyeglasses, maybe dental care, in some cases gym memberships. But what research has consistently found is that we, the taxpayer, are paying about 14% more for these managed care plans than for the traditional fee-for-service. And if you recall, the promise of managed care was, we're going to be more efficient, we're going to do things for less money. So there's been this dichotomy of, wait, if you're more efficient, why are we paying you 14%, what many of the Democrats call an overpayment? And so President Obama and many of the Democrats have been saying consistently all year that they want to ratchet down those payments. How the companies will deal with that and what it will mean for beneficiaries, we don't yet know.
And finally, I want to turn to a question from Leslie in North Carolina, who wants to know why the Senate is against the public option. And this gives us a chance to talk a little bit about the nuances of what actually, who's against, who's for, and what really happened this week with the public option debate.
Right. I mean, there is a lot of people in the Senate. Some are for it and some are against it. President Obama's position is that he really likes it, but he's not going to insist on it. But that's proven to be a very difficult political message to get across. It's much easier from a political standpoint to say you like something and you're going to defend it to the death, or you hate it and you don't want to hear anything more about it. To say I really like it a lot, but you know what? I'm open to alternatives too. That's proven difficult for him. And so it seems like every few days he says something about the public option that either gets interpreted as he's dropping it, he's backing away, or he's reaffirming his support. It's been kind of a tough issue for them. In the Senate, you know, it's not, you know, there's a certain amount of skepticism toward it on the part of Republicans, but also some moderate Democrats. And what they're afraid of is they're afraid that, you know, it's supposed to compete with insurance companies, keep them honest, but what they're afraid of is that ultimately the insurance companies won't be able to compete, they'll drop out, and increasingly we'll have a public health care system. So that's the response that you hear.
And yet the president says nothing's changed.
Right, nothing's changed. He hasn't changed his position. And you can find words in the past where he has said, look, I'm flexible, right, and this is not new.
Right.
On the other hand, what's really fascinating about this is it shows that while these ads and the shouting at the town halls has all been about a conservative backlash against it, he's also facing a lot of pressure on the left, which is very upset about the idea that he would drop a public option. And right now he's kind of being buffeted by both sides and trying to find a middle ground in a very polarized debate.
Perhaps when he's on vacation this week, he'll figure out where that middle ground is. Thank you all very much for your questions also and your answers. We'll see you again next week on our Washington Week webcast extra.